This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You know, the image of the sheriff's deputy chasing the bad guy across the landscape on the back of a horse is a pretty common image if you're talking about a Hollywood Western or a Louis L'Amour novel or even real life in the latter part of the 19th century. But what about today in the 21st century? Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb for The Horse Show. Believe it or not, horses are still an integral part of law enforcement in many areas. And we're going to find out today how they're being used by the largest sheriff's department in the entire country, the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. My guest is Rod Bergen, who is in charge of training mounted patrol officers for the L.A. County Sheriff's Department. He's going to talk about some of the challenges faced in getting the horses ready for this and how he goes about imparting the sense of psychology that you need in working with horses in this day and age to the sheriff's officers that need to know this stuff. So it's a fascinating discussion. Rod is an outstanding horseman on his own and a subscriber to the whole notion of psychological or natural horsemanship. And he'll be with us for the entire hour today. This, by the way, was the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers from the Western States Horse Expo, one of the biggest and best expos we attend every year. Now, speaking of events that we attend every year, or I hope at least it's going to be every year, 2014 was the first one. It is happening again on March 1st of 2015. I'm talking, of course, about RFD-TV's The American, the richest one-day rodeo of all time. As I said, March 1st, 2015, AT&T Stadium, Cowboys football stadium in Arlington, Texas, which is the Dallas-Fort Worth area. The reason we were there last year and are going to be there again this year is because RFD-TV invited all the folks that have programs on their network, such as us, the Horse Show, to come and have a booth there in the fan zone and meet the fans, which I love to do. So we were there for that, kind of knew what to expect about that. What I didn't anticipate was how cool the actual rodeo was going to be. And it had a unique hook to it. And the hook was, first of all, you have to understand that they invited world champions in all the different rodeo events to come and be part of this. And then also they had a series of qualifying rodeos that allowed anybody, almost like a walk-on, to qualify to be in this final event there and go up against the world champions. And whoever won his or her class, and I think there were like eight different rodeo classes, walked away with $100,000, which was incredible for a day's work to start with. But there was a side pot of $1 million that was set aside if an individual who was a qualifier, not a world champion, took his or her class, and a young man named Rich Champion won it. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. We'll be back.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention The Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention The Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with a lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
All right, well, welcome, everybody. I'm Rick Lamb from The Horse Show radio program, and this is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers from the Western States Horse Expo. And after that long introduction, I want to introduce the real star of my show, which is my guest today, Rod Bergen.
Thank you very much, Rick. It's a pleasure being here.
All right, we're going to talk today. Rod, by the way, for those of you who don't yet know him, I suspect you probably will as time goes on, because he's becoming more and more of a presence in our horse industry. Won in 2001 a very important award, and I want to talk about that first. It was the Mounted Patrol Training Officer of the Year, and this was awarded by the American Riding Instructors Certification Program. Congratulations on that. Rod, tell us a little bit about that particular award.
Well, thank you very much, Rick. What happens is every year the American Riding Instructors Association selects people who've shown a great degree of proficiency in certain areas. Several years ago, it was recognized that the Mounted Patrol Training Officer was very, very important, because indeed horses are used in law enforcement in a very efficient and positive manner if they're used correctly. So what happens every year, they make the selection. And this particular year, in 2001, I was selected, and my department, the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department, was selected to get this award, and I feel very proud of receiving it.
Now, this is a topic unto itself, so we're not going to go into it at great depth, but just talk for a moment about the need, in your opinion, for certification of riding instructors.
Well, it's very interesting to note, Rick, that you don't go to a doctor who's not licensed, and you do not go to an attorney who's not licensed. However, you're all of a sudden being given lessons in one of the probably most dangerous recreational sports by an individual that has not been proven to meet any standard. So the purpose of certification is to define a set of standards by which the individual taking the lessons can be somewhat assured that it'll be a safe and positive program.
Now, this has been around for a while. The ARICP has been with us for a while, correct?
Yes, Rick, it has.
The problem... Why doesn't it just dominate? Why hasn't everybody jumped on board?
Well, unfortunately, the part of the problem may be the fact that it is not legislated. And we do not want it to be legislated, because if it's legislated, undoubtedly, people who are not familiar with horses or riders will be making the decisions. As a consequence, it's kind of an optional matter. One thing that is interesting is that some of the insurance companies will give a reduced insurance rate to those individuals that are certified, and therefore that helps. But it seems as though once an individual has taken 3 lessons, they're all of a sudden a trainer, and they're teaching the person next door how to hopefully survive on this animal that... As an aside, I might mention it's 3 to 5 times faster than a human, 10 to 20 times stronger than a human, and hold on, he'll outthink you, or she will outthink you. And that's hard for people to deal with.
All right, you got to explain that statement. I know a lot of people are going to take exception to that.
That is indeed correct, because quite often, if we are failing in our communication or our training program with our horses, we naturally assume the horse is a stupid animal. He's a dumb animal. One of the things that we've done in modern police work is we've started researching more of how the horse thinks. It'd be interesting to know that there are 2 parts of your brain, basically the cerebellum and the cerebrum. Now, in our case, our cerebrum in relation to our cerebellum is smaller than the relationship in a horse. What does that mean? That means the horse has a higher level of instinctual capability. He can process information in many times quite faster than we can. And if you want an example of that, take that 1,200-pound horse. Coming down the hill, he has to stop right where you are. Everything comes together, and he does it. That takes a lot of processing, if you want to consider it in computer terms.
We tend to think that thinking is more rational thought, logic, reasoning, and so forth. So we're redefining our terms a little bit to say that the horse outthinks us.
Well, exactly. The point is, if you consider basically the ability to process information, there are two distinct divisions. One is the ability to abstract, to come up with new ideas based upon the bringing together of various independent elements, sometimes called gestalt, sometimes called synergistic. The horse does not do that. He cannot conceptualize, but by and large, I find very few humans who can either. The other is, the other is the ability to process information rapidly. Your computer can go through all these iterations very, very rapidly. If it is relevant to the horse's survival, he will process that information extremely rapidly. Because why? He's been doing it for 55 million years. So he's got it pretty well figured out. He is always in the moment. And I asked Ray Hunt one time. I said, Ray, you've dealt with a few horses in your life and individuals. I find if it takes me 1 hour to get a horse to a certain level, it may take 3 to 5 hours for the human. What do you think? He said, if you're lucky.
Yeah. Well, that's a great point. And, of course, that's the challenge that all of us face in the horse industry is not training horses, but training people. I mean, the horse is kind of the easy part of all of this in many ways. We're going to talk today about how you go about training a police horse and what we can extrapolate from that to training all horses or what would help us with our backyard or trail-type horses. But a little bit about your background. Were you a horseman who got interested in law enforcement or a law enforcement officer who got interested in horses?
Your first point, Rick, I was a horseman, have been for many years. And as a result of doing some work with the state park system, I was invited to get involved with the LA County Sheriff's Department. And because of my capabilities, I went up to a fairly rapid level into their training program. The problem is that quite often there are a lot of law enforcement people out there who can deal with their job, but they don't understand how to work with horses. And as an aside, it's kind of interesting to consider. I work in the Special Enforcement Bureau, where the SWAT guys are. And these are the guys who go in with fully automatic weapons and rip down the walls and do all this slam and bang type stuff. And you say to these fellows, you've got to be the dominant mare in your horse's life. And he gets a very strange look. But as an interesting aspect of that, I found that if you work with individuals with what they know, you can then convey information that you're trying to impart to them. So I started thinking, well, what the heck? When a law enforcement officer goes to apprehend a suspect, the thing he watches is the body language. You always watch these because the hands are what are going to get you. So I said, treat your horse as a suspect. And it's amazing the difference it made, because now they started seeing the horse. What a horse does is not as important as how a horse prepares to do it. What we miss is the preparatory stages.
I'm talking with Rod Bergen about the training of horses for law enforcement. This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clipper from the Western States Horse Expo. I'm Rick Lamb. When we get back, verbal judo. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com.
Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hello, I'm Leslie Nielsen, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. Remember, a wet bird never flies at night.
The late, great comic actor Leslie Nielsen, we do miss him. My guest is Rod Bergen. We're coming from the Western States Horse Expo. When we're talking about the use of horses in law enforcement and some of the training involved.
The other thing that works very well, in the state of California, there was considerable money spent on a thing called verbal judo. All law enforcement officers went through the verbal judo. And what that simply states is, when you go to apprehend a suspect, come on very quietly, very softly, because you can escalate up, but you can't come down. So if you come in too fast, you're all of a sudden possibly into deadly force, and that's not good. Well, let's do that with our horses. Let's ask as quietly and easily as we can, so that we can get the results we're trying to achieve for the horse.
I've seen that on cops, actually. I've noticed them doing that. They talk very calmly and like they're old friends with these guys as they're slamming them against the car and putting the cuffs on them. So, I mean, it kind of catches them a little off guard, I think.
Well, it does. It does. And, of course, in the same point of view, it's very interesting that when you are trying to get people to do something that they may not want to do, such as move in a crowd, the horse can be very effective there. For example, when we did the World Cup soccer matches, the CHP people, maybe around here somewhere, would come in on their little scooters, and nobody seemed to care. And the guys on the ground would kind of, you know, talk to them, they didn't care. But when you have the south end of a 1,200-pound quarter horse coming your way, you will move.
Well, that kind of leads right into what I wanted to ask you, is why horses in this modern day and age are valuable in law enforcement, what they can do that makes them worth the trouble and the extra training and all of that in this modern time?
Well, actually, Rick, that's a good question. It goes back to Genghis Khan.
Okay.
who found, he was not a nice soul, by the way. If you read about Genghis, he was a bad dude. But he found that when you come in with your herd of Mongols on horseback, that those poor suckers on the ground were having a real problem with it. And it's considered today that one well-trained mounted officer on a properly trained horse is worth at least 10 on the ground. We have a higher visibility. We have the ability to move you without getting into the batons and what have you. So it has that kind of an impact. It also has the effect of being very calming to start with. Most people like horses. So if you have two cops coming into a mall, let's say to do some checkout at Christmas time, if you come in a black and white, everybody kind of turns their head the other way and hopes they won't be seen. Not everybody, but some people. However, when you come in on a horse, everybody wants to tell you about their granddad back in Wisconsin, about how they rode as a kid. So it opens the door quite a bit, too.
So public relations-wise, it's something, a commonality, I think, that people relate to. Everybody's familiar with, I guess, you know, when people see a police car, they think immediately, gosh, I hope I'm not doing something wrong. I'm not in trouble. But I guess they don't have that reaction when they see an officer on a horse.
No, they don't. It works very well. It's interesting, too, that we're with the L.A. County Sheriff's Department, and one of our duties is to do beach patrol. So we take our horses on the beach, and we see to it that the folks there on the beach behave themselves. Now, it is occasionally one of those situations where you might have some young lady who wants a trip to the water because she doesn't want to walk across the sand, and we have to say we carry no passengers. So we cannot be that much of a public relations unit.
Now, does that really happen, Rod?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. There have been people.
And you have to turn them down, huh?
Well, yeah.
That's too bad.
Yeah. No,
okay,
it does
ahead.
Happen.
Sorry.
But you can borrow my horse sometime if you want.
Impersonate an officer.
Right, right. But we had a couple of lads one time that decided that after doing what they were doing, they did not want to kneel down. Now, one side aspect is, as a regular law enforcement officer, to get an individual to kneel is considered very demeaning, and we can't do it. But when you're on horse, you can, because they recognize that there's a whole different situation. Well, these lads decided that they didn't want to hang around, that they might just kind of leave the scene rapidly, which turned out not to be a good choice. Because you may know that a human can run how fast? Maybe 8 miles an hour. And a horse can go how fast? Maybe 35 or 40 miles an hour, though we don't use racehorses for this. But yeah, it's extremely effective.
What type of horse have you found is best for police work? Is there any type, or is it just an individual thing?
Well, Rick, that's an excellent question. It's probably, of all the questions I'm asked, probably one of the more common ones. It is an individual thing. But if we talk about breeds, when I ask the question of the audience, and I say, what do you think would be the best horse for law enforcement? Typically, I hear quarter horse and warm blood. That's their main choice. What would you feel might be the least positive type breed? And it comes up thoroughbreds and Arabs. Mm-hmm. Quite the opposite. I can do more with a thoroughbred and Arab than I can with a laid-back quarter horse or a warm blood. By the way, I own one thoroughbred, three quarter horses, three warm bloods, and an Arab. So I've got in my own.
You've got all of them. You've got personal experience on that line. So what is it about the Arab or the thoroughbred that you like for this kind of work? It would seem that they would perhaps be a little too excitable or, you know, too sensitive.
They are sensitive, and they do get excitable. The question you have to ask is, why do they get excited? I've got a whole thing that I go through talking about the comfort zone of a horse, which we don't have time to go through today. But the point of this is that if you have a horse that has a lot of energy, typically that's associated with a lot of drive. I can direct that. I can control that. Any clinician out here, if you ask him what he'd rather work with, a hot horse or a cold horse, he'll tell you a hot horse.
Because they've got to move to train
absolutely.
Them.
Absolutely. Yeah. And they have to be able to be taken up and taken down. Now, you take the laid-back, so-called bomb-proof quarter horse, to get him up so you can bring him down sometimes takes an awful lot.
A lot of your energy, a lot of your focus when you need to be thinking about something else.
And you tend to set him off a little bit. Most training of horses deals with only two of the three primary elements. They deal with the mental. How do you go about and do these particular moves? They deal with the physical. How do you get the muscle structure set up so it can be done? They leave out quite often that most important one, which is the psychological. I will take and lay down in front of our guests here a 2x12, about 8 feet long. And assuming you haven't had tequila sunrises for breakfast or whatever, you all can take and put one foot in front of the other and walk that 2x12. And I haven't found anybody yet who has not been able to do that. So let's take that 2x12 and put it 30 stories up. How many volunteers? Well, what happened? You can still do it physically. You can still do it mentally. But now you have an emotional issue. So what do we need? A bigger crop. A set of spurs. That's the answer.
Of course. No, we're being facetious.
Yes, please. Understand that I don't go into a lot of stuff as an instinctual training aids. However, the point I'm making is that if you allow the horse to do what he's able to do, if you don't ask him to do more than he's capable of doing at that time, you can reap the benefits.
What do law enforcement horses wear on their feet? My guest, Rod Bergen, Mounted Patrol Training Officer of the Year for L.A. County Sheriff's Department, will tell us when we get back. This is The Horse Show Live. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. Six panels make a 13-foot round pin. Eight panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
My guest is Rod Bergen. We're talking about the training of horses for law enforcement. As a practical matter, you're taking these horses into settings where they're on concrete or they're on a variety of different kind of footings. What do you do about shoes?
Well, that's a good question. And we do get a borium allowance as part of our pay schedule to put borium in the shoes of the horses.
Better explain what that means.
Okay, basically what happens is that the shoe itself is a steel shoe and will tend to slip on concrete. The borium tends to dig into the concrete and tends to lock them down. For example, this horse going by right now, if it had borium in its shoes, would not slip forward. On the other hand, if he goes down a steep incline, he might have his horse's feet slip forward. What we do is we use easy boots. Easy boots work very, very well, with the exception of areas that you run into things like oil and what have you. And we did have a problem. We do security in the Rose Parade. And we had one of our riders come around the corner where the cameras are. One of the floats had dropped some diesel fuel and some oil on the pavement, and unfortunately, this horse did slip on it. Mm. So it's not the ultimate answer, but it tends to be the answer. It also is not that well if you're dealing on wet grass. They tend to slip. So there's no ideal answer to it. But we tend to, answer your question, use easy boots most of the time.
What about the saddles and the tack that you use?
The LA Sheriff's Department Posse was started many years ago. Monty Montana was our chief at that time. Eventually, these individuals were sworn personnel and became part of the department. And they all had Western tack. Western tack being what these guys were used to because they were a bunch of cowboys. The sheriff was a cowboy. So that went along very well until 1984, when the Olympics were coming to Los Angeles, and there was a threat of terrorism. This terrorism is not a new thing. It's been around. So the LA Sheriff's Department said, we have to have officers who can deal with any situation. As a result, the department selected English tack. By that, I mean English saddles. Typically, dressage saddles work very well. The downside is, if you want to try to dally up a suspect, you can't do it because you don't have a horn. We're not supposed to rope anymore. We could rope suspects. We can't do it anymore.
Oh, that was one of my questions.
Yeah,
you don't get to do that.
No,
huh?
They took it away from us.
That's too bad.
And we can't jump off the horse on them, even though LAPD can. We can't jump off and...
No steer wrestling, huh?
Yeah, no steer wrestling. Okay. So, but the point is, with a English saddle, you have a closer contact. and you can feel your horse better. And when you're dealing with very, very tight situations, such as riding into a gang fight to stop it, you need to have as much contact as you can possibly have. So the posse wears a type of green Levi, the regular sheriff's shirt, and cowboy hats. The mounted enforcement detail, of which I'm a member, wears basically motorcycle pants with stripes down the side, Dainer motorcycle boots. By the way, originally, we were trying to use motorcycle pants. Now, if you try to get on a 16-hand horse with 10 pounds of gun belt on you and pants that don't stretch, it is very difficult. So we now have double stretch pants, and we have the campaign hats, and that was chosen as the uniform for the mounted enforcement detail. So
it's basically an English-type saddle that you're using?
Yes. I happen to use a Passier. I mean, the department does not have the money to buy saddles for people. So basically, you can pretty much use anything as long as it's a English saddle.
And the whole issue of not being pulled off, you just address that through training?
Well, there are two types of riding positions. When I teach equitation, I teach a balanced seat. And I go through all the business, how you don't have any space between your feet and the stirrups, and you ride in a upright, balanced position. On the other hand, in law enforcement, we teach what we call the combat position, somewhat similar to the way a cutter or roper sometimes do. You lock yourself down. So instead of having all your joints loose, which those of you who have taken a lot of lessons know you should do, keeping your joints loose allows you to ride with your horse. This is exactly the opposite. We lock them down so that if you try to grab me, it's going to be a problem. See, what we do is if you take somebody off a horse, it's very simple. You walk up, you kick their foot out of the stirrup, lift them over, and they're gone.
Mm-hmm.
That's very easy. So what we have to worry about...
We shouldn't be telling people this.
We have to worry about drunk cowboys. We go into the situation. Sometimes these guys are a problem. But that's only one method. There are many methods. But anyway, we do a different type of seating.
You know, you have some general thoughts about training that I think would apply to anybody, not just somebody that's going to train a horse for law enforcement. Let's talk a little bit about those. One of the things that you mentioned that I thought was just fascinating was what you call the rules of disengagement. Explain what that means.
Yeah, Rick, that is, to me, a very salient point. Those of you folks that have driven a manual stick car know that you do not change gears until you put the clutch in. Why do you put the clutch in? To disengage the engine. What happens to many people is they don't understand that when you make any transition in a horse, you need to basically shift gears. And you do this by taking him out of the gear he was in so that he can go into the gear you want him to be in. So I call this the rules of disengagement. Now, what are some examples of that? Those of you folks that have done dressage and know a half halt, that's pretty much a large part of it. The reason you do a half halt is not a corrective move, it's a preparatory move. And when...
It's almost a pre-signal a little bit.
But definitely.
Get ready, something new is coming here.
When Reiner Klimke wrote in one of his books years ago, the fact that he would do hundreds of half halts around the throughout his rides, that made no sense to me. Until I started understanding what you need to do, and you're absolutely right on the money. It's a signal. You're saying something is about to happen. Are you with me? If you're not getting positive feedback, then don't try to do it. This is where you end up with incorrect lead changes. Okay? Quite often, people try to get the correct lead, but because they're trying to make it happen, they get the incorrect lead because they did not allow the horse to set himself up in such a way that that first outside driving leg can lift the entire horse and go into a three-beat canter.
Well, so much of it, and this applies not only to changing leads, but just about everything, is asking your horse to do something at a time when he can actually comply, when he can actually do it. In other words, if you're asking for one of these great reining stops, these guys that when they utter whoa, when they sit down in the seat, it's at a specific point in the stride of that horse that the horse can actually do what they're asking. Same thing you're talking about, changing leads and all these other things. So a lot of it is knowing where your horse is at every given moment and being fair about what you ask him to do at that moment.
Well, you mentioned a word which I think ought to be really put up in bright lights, fair. Justice. This is very important working with horses, but you're right on the money. What you need to do is you need to set your horse up so that he can do it. Now, you all know that a horse can do virtually everything it's going to do the rest of his life within a few hours after it's born. So we don't need to worry about that. What we need to worry about is getting a rider to be able to stay out of his horse's way so that he can do what he has to do. And quite often, the example I use is the slinky. If you got a slinky, it goes back and forth, back and forth. But your cousin or somebody comes along and kind of kinks your slinky, it don't slink no more. So you, the rider, quite often are the kink in your horse's slinky. That horse has a rhythm. If you interrupt that rhythm, he cannot be prepared to do it. So, yes, we're setting him up so he is able to do it.
Another key point that you make that I found very curious, and I want to hear, I'm sure you've got a great reason for it, is not to overdo the desensitization of horses. I mean, that's something you hear talked about all the time, and I think it's largely in reaction to the fact that we've got a huge population of horse enthusiasts who don't have a lot of experience with horses, and we're first and foremost wanting to keep them safe. So we're wanting horses not to overreact to stimuli. But you say don't overdo the desensitization. Explain why you said that.
Actually, Rick, I go a step further, and I say don't worry about desensitizing your horse. I mean, if you could... You could do that by drugs and whatever if you want to desensitize your horse, but I want a horse that's highly sensitive, particularly if I'm going into a situation which is a combat situation, and basically we train warriors on horseback. What I want is my horse to be extremely sensitive. What I want him to be able to do is to distinguish between that which is a stimulus that is something he should be frightened of and that which is a stimulus which he can use with no problem. If you watch here again, these clinicians, and I've sometimes given talks on how to watch clinicians and get the most out of them, you're going to find that they'll go through a process where, first off, let's say the horse is to be sacked out. You apply the stimulus until the horse basically understands that is not a thing to be feared. Once he understands it's not to be feared, then you can use it to basically control motion. What's an example of that? Let's take the rope. If you take a horse that's never been handled before and start throwing a rope around, what's going to happen? We know he's going to scoot. But yet, I've got to be able to work a rope off my horse. My horse has to be able to distinguish, is that rope something that he can tolerate because it's not a threat? Or am I going to use my rope to tap on my horse, which is the way we teach bridleless riding?
And of course, the difference is your intent.
Exactly.
And they read that.
Exactly. That is so much the point. I'll tell you, that is so... These horses are so sensitive. They can determine very much where you are at. So I come up, and I have people do this. You walk up to your horse, and you stroke his neck. You walk up again now with more energy in your body, and you expect your horse to yield to you, and he should yield to you. And they can make the difference as long as you are aware in your own mind what your intentions are, because sometimes people don't know what they are asking.
Yeah, yeah, you have to know what you want before you can ask for it really effectively and know whether you even got it. Rod, the future of the use of horses in law enforcement, do you see that as something that's going to increase? Is it on the wane? What is the state? Look into the future a little bit for me.
Well, I have to be honest because I consider myself an honest person, so I have to give you the really honest answer. And that is that we're having more and more trouble getting people to really get involved in mounted work. A lot of the horse groups, their ranks are going down. I find very few people that have really been around horses for a good period of time, and that is so important that you really feel comfortable with them. So I'd say overall, I see it kind of as diminishing, but the ones we have now that we're using, I see them being used more effectively.
All right, my guest is Rod Bergen, Mounted Patrol Training Officer of the Year. And we're talking about the training of horses for law enforcement. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. When we return, questions from the audience.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Yeah.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
We have made tremendous inroads thanks to people like you, and we can use your help even more today. Spread the word about The Horse Show. That's all it takes. Just tell your friends. My guest is Rod Bergen. We're talking about the training of horses for law enforcement, and we have a question right here.
Yeah, Rod, doing police work, and I know that's a dangerous situation when you get into crowd control. What do you do to protect the horse from knifings and stabbings in their gut from, you know, these idiots who are out there to do it when you're in the crowd?
That's an excellent question, and indeed it is a threat. The threat goes all the way from what you mentioned, somebody attempting to actually stab the horse, to putting ball bearings out in the street so that they start slipping on the ball bearings, to pepper spray up the nose. Now, the last is the most dangerous. If your horse gets pepper spray, you may have to get him out of the situation however you can. They can tolerate tear gas. Most people don't realize that. You go into a situation, we have to mask up, but the horse doesn't. They can handle tear gas. We carry a 40-inch, we call a horse baton. It's also a bokan. It's a martial arts tool. And we use this effectively to try to keep you away from my horse. So the first thing I do, if you look like you're a threat to my horse, is probably knock you down with my horse. And my horses are trained to do that. They really are very effective. When we had some people jump on one of the Rose Parade floats, I came along, the guy had gotten on, I grabbed him. My quarter horse at that time flipped on the ground, a deputy caught him, it was all over. This is one of the reasons that Pasadena uses us. You could not have done it so quickly and so effectively. So we use the horse baton, and we have a series of strikes we use in that area. But primarily, it's a matter of just keeping your awareness up and watching out. We don't use reins that can unhook. We don't go into any of that stuff.
What kind of reins do you use?
They're continual reins. We don't use split reins. And a lot of us use a Makati, if you feel comfortable. And the reason the Makati is that when you get off to write a ticket or do whatever you have to do, you have to be able to keep your horse in tow. So a large number...
That lead rope essentially built in.
Exactly. Yeah. Right.
Okay, good. Anybody else have a question? Yes, ma'am.
Do you provide training for other agencies, or are people allowed to come to your area to train? Or
well, that's also a very good question. The LA County Sheriff's Department is probably the largest sheriff's department in the world. I guess we have a lot of I forget how many deputies and whatever. We have a lot, so we do the training for basically all of the police agencies in LA County, with the exception of LAPD. They have their own facility. They own their own horses. In the sheriff's department, we simply use our horses, and they have to go through the training. As far as training for individuals, typically if you wanted to become involved with a department, you could, in many cases, come in as a civilian volunteer. As a civilian volunteer, you would receive training in certain of the areas. We do not teach self-defense. There are four elements of police training. There's equitation, there's self-defense, there's the sensory training, and formation work. So these elements, you could learn a lot of it, but you would not get into defensive tactics.
Did you have a follow-up on that?
I did. My question was for other agencies, say other agencies outside of L.A. County, like El Dorado County.
No, they can if they'd like to. If they wanted to, they could work through our agency and they could come and get the training. But by and large, it's all within L.A. County, but certainly another agency could contract with us to do it, yes.
How does a law enforcement officer that wants to get out of, say, walking a beat or whatever the equivalent of that is today, and wants to get into this aspect of it, how do they become part of your program? Is there a waiting list? Do they have to, you know, audition or what? I mean, not audition. That's not the right word. Apply.
Well, actually, we are...
Sing a song. I don't know.
Right. Yeah.
As I said, Los Angeles, after all.
Well, yeah, do a rap number or whatever. Right. Well, we, as I said earlier, are kind of struggling for people. So basically, if you came in and had no experience whatsoever, we would first off suggest that you take riding lessons because we're really not structured to work with beginners. It so happens, coincidentally, I do teach at Pierce College and I work with complete beginners. So we would suggest to you that you go to some place where you can at least get your fundamentals worked out because you should be able to walk, trot, and canter before you become part of the program. Then from that point on, we have different tiered levels of training. There are different areas you can work. For example, a mall patrol where you're just standing there watching people and you see somebody break in a car and you don't necessarily apprehend them, but you tell somebody, that's a very low level and doesn't require a lot of skill and training. When you go up, however, to the level that you are actually working with people in crowd situations where somebody could seriously get hurt, that's another whole thing. And one of the tests we do before deploying the street is to have you sit out there on your horse, you drop the reins, you touch the skids of a helicopter, that's how close he is, while they set off M80s and smoke grenades underneath your horse. So we want to make sure you've got a reasonable semblance of control.
And if you live through it, then you can join the force. Okay. Gosh. Well, what about this? The public relations aspect of this I know is huge, where, you know, the public is drawn to the horse, you know, it's good from all that connecting with the public. But what about them inadvertently doing things that might irritate or set off the horse, kids getting underneath the horse, that kind of things. How do you deal with that?
That, once again, is an exceptionally good question. Our whole philosophy is you never touch our horse's face. If you appear to be an individual on the ground who is very peaceful, which most people are, we suggest you stroke the neck. We watch that they do not get around our horse's rear end because, once again, these are well-trained horses, but they are horses. So we just try to maintain a perimeter of safety. The reality is that when you get into a really large crowd situation, sometimes it's difficult to do that. So, however, what we would do is we would not come in longitudinally, we come in laterally. We typically use a side pass motion. And therefore, you can get a better handle on who's where because you can see the front and the rear of your horse. And also, by the way, as an aside, we teach you when you learn to shoot off your horse's back, the number one thing is not to shoot your horse. And so as a result, you should always be at least 90 degrees to your horse's head before you discharge your weapon.
Well, that was one of the things I wanted to ask is, I mean, cowboy-mounted shooting's huge now, and one of the things that, you know, they go through, of course, is desensitizing a horse to the gunfire. How do you deal with that? Is it similar to how they do it?
Well, I work with some of the single-action shooters. I tend to do things a little bit differently. Some agencies or some groups like to basically expose the horse to everything there is. In other words, throw the kid in the water and see if he swims. To me, that's not a good way to do things. So I work at a much lower level. As an aside, if anybody wants to practice shooting off your horse's back, I would strongly suggest you do not sit on your horse's back, raise your arm, and bust a cap. Because what will happen, the horse will learn very quickly, every time the arm goes up, that he should be moving aside. So as a result, you may raise your arm, and somebody may light a ladyfinger or an M80 or something over there, but it's not associated necessarily with you bringing your arm up because horses learn very quickly. The interesting part about it is people say, well, what's the big deal about teaching people to shoot off a horse's back? What do the old cowboys do? Well, a lot of the old cowboys didn't have gunfights off horseback anyway. But the other part of it is if you ride a horse 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, you can tango on his back. What we have is a problem with the horse. He's in the backyard for a month, and you bring him out. And also, on that note, when you're dealing with spookiness or anything else, there are three parameters you must maintain awareness of. One is the proximity of the stimulus. Two is the magnitude of the stimulus. And three is the direction of the stimulus. So that a firecracker close up is a bigger deal than a stick of dynamite half a mile away. So we bring the horse up gradually through these processes. And as a result, we're pretty good. The last note on that is people say, what do the old guys do in the cavalry? Well, in the cavalry, they had tons of horses. And a lot of the horses, if they couldn't handle it, they got rid of them. We don't have that option, or most of us don't.
Yeah, well, you pointed out something there that I think we always have to bear in mind is the way Hollywood has represented, you know, life in the 1870s, or this relatively short period in American history when the American cowboy was at its peak, is not exactly the way it was. There's a little bit of difference. Rod Bergen, thank you for being here today.
Thank you, Rick. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you all for coming.
And all I can say in closing is just be fair to your horse and always remember that this is a living, feeling entity. And just be fair. Thank you for
having me.
You know, this sort of interview always reminds me of the relevance of the horse in modern times. And it's a theme I know that I talk about a lot. I hope you don't get tired of hearing it. But it's amazing to me that here we are over 100 years ago now that Henry Ford kind of put the horse on the road to obsolescence by introducing the mass-produced Model T automobile. That was kind of the beginning of the end of the horse's utilitarian object, if you will. And still, horses have relevance in modern life, and we all know that they do as far as helping people rehabilitate and reach people with emotional and mental problems and abused and neglected kids and people that are just trying to make themselves better people. The horse is a vehicle for all of that. And also this sense that we heard about today where the horse is still a very useful tool in the sense of getting real work done in law enforcement. And we've had a number of people on our show talking about this. Scott Hansen, who was a mounted police officer in Seattle, retired from that and is now teaching self-defense for trail riders. We had earlier on our TV show this past year, I went out and rode with the Mounted Volunteers of Antelope Valley, also part of the LA County Sheriff's Department. And it's rigorous. You know, they don't trivialize the use of the horse. They try and do it right. They realize it's a tremendous tool, very powerful, force for good. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lane.